Hi, this is Jens Berthel Askou. You're listening to the Nordic Football Podcast.
Hello everybody and welcome to the latest episode of the Nordic Football Podcast. Great to be back for another episode, and we are heading this week to a different part of Scandinavia, or the Nordics in general. We're in the Faroe Islands and we are here to talk to the manager of HB Tórshavn. I hope I've got the pronunciation correct there. The winning derby manager, Jens Berthel Askou, who joins us now, fresh after the derby win today against B36, a top-of-the-table clash. Jens, thank you so much for joining us on the show. How are you?
I'm fantastic. It's been a great day, not just for me, but for at least half of Tórshavn.
Yeah, can imagine, yeah. We watched the game, actually, so we have been following Faroe Islands football a little bit in the last few weeks, because there's been no football in, obviously, as you know, in Norway, Sweden, you know, Denmark until just recently. So Faroe Islands has become quite a popular league of late. Tell us, firstly, let's start with the game. You won the derby today. The season's just started, and you are now top of the league after today's win. And just to anyone who's listening who doesn't know the league that well, the two teams are derby rivals. I believe they share the same stadium as well, and so this was a really big game today, and you won it 4-2. So, you must be feeling great. And tell us about the game itself and everything.
Yeah, of course, we're happy right now. We've been looking forward to the game. Both teams, both clubs have had a good start of the season with 4 out of 4 wins, and now today we faced, until now, our toughest opponent, and I think that the game developed as we've anticipated, with them being very direct and trying to bring a lot of balls, you know, into the box and into, you know, to their strike, and then play from there with a lot of set pieces also, and where we have a different style, where we try to create and use space all around the pitch and move them out of position. And I think we started the game really well, and were 1-0 up, and should have been 2-0 up before then they suddenly got a penalty out of nothing and got back into the game. And then second half was a bit of the same story, us dominating and creating most chances, and then suddenly they were 2-1 up on a counter attack, and then of course we had to keep calm and keep doing what we were doing, because it was working. We just needed a little bit more quality, and then within a couple of minutes the momentum changed totally, with us scoring 2 goals and then having a guy send off after a nasty tackle, and then we sealed it off, you know, in overtime. And it was a great feeling, you know, especially after the 4-2 goal, where we could just sit and enjoy the last couple of minutes.
For sure, it was an up and down game, and it was really to be honest, I've been quite impressed with the level that I've seen so far in the Faroe Islands. I have to be honest, this is the first time I've really watched the league in the last sort of maybe month since the season began, but I've been pretty impressed. Tell us about the standard of the league in general and your impressions, because you joined the club in December 2019, so this is
in
your
December,
this is your first season. What have been your impressions so far of Faroe Islands football?
Well, of course, there's been many impressions, and everything has been new to me as well. I didn't know much about the team and the league when I came, but it was a great opportunity for me, first of all, to get a top team, and you know, early in my career, and to develop a team with a lot of focus on the attacking part of the football. And build a team and a club, rebuild a club, you know, to fight for the championship, which, you know, last season we struggled and finished fourth or fifth, and we had to rebuild. We lost a lot of experienced players at the start, you know, at the end of last season, and had to build up with a lot of new players and a lot of young players too. And I think we've come a long way, and it's been good for us to have that long and extra preseason, because we've been able to work on a lot of things and have a lot of time to work on the little details of the game. And as you said, there are good players up here, decent players, and a lot of young players who definitely will be able to take it to the next level. I think it's not almost as organized, and there's a lot of bad tackles, which don't get the attention from the referees that they should.
I saw a few today. Yeah.
So it means that it's very aggressive and very physical, but you also have players who can play football, with speed and technical abilities, and especially I think my squad has a lot of interesting young technical players with speed and stamina and aggressiveness, and they're learning every day. And it's been interesting to work with these players. I have players who I'm sure will take it to a level that's a lot higher than where they are right now.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, you're a young manager. You're 37, I believe. Is that correct?
Yeah.
And
that's correct.
Your playing career, you played for many teams, including Norwich City and the Premier in English football, which we'll talk about in a minute. But firstly, I wanted to ask you. You mentioned just there you moved there in December, and you're a young coach. This is one of your first sort of major managerial jobs. You were recently at Vendissel, I believe, before that. HB Tórshavn, and they're quite a big club in Faroe Islands. That historically, they've won the league 23 times. And you mentioned there, last season they didn't finish so well. What was the challenge, and how did the move come about for you? How did you actually end up in the Faroe Islands, and what attracted you, and that kind of, what's the expectations from the club maybe when you were joining?
Well, those are good questions, and a lot of people have asked me that, especially in Denmark, because in Denmark and in Danish football, we tend to not really, sometimes we look down on the smaller Scandinavian football countries.
Yeah,
and I don't really know why, because I think in Denmark, if all the bigger countries, they looked down on us and didn't really rate us and respect us, we wouldn't be able to go everywhere, and a lot of Danish players move abroad and do well and has done over time, and I think Faroe Islands is maybe the next undiscovered and one of the few undiscovered countries with players who are interesting for bigger countries, and I think with all the attention that we've had now, it kind of people start to realize that actually there are players up here who are really good and who would be able to take it to the next level. And of course, there's a lot of, there's a big gap from top to bottom in terms of level of the teams, which results in a lot of, big wins.
Sure.
But the top teams, they have good players. And one of the reasons that it was interesting for me, as I mentioned before, was when I stopped in Vendsyssel after having my first job as a head coach, took the team to the Super League, and had a good season where we beat with the club that weren't really ready for the and a team that weren't really ready for for the big league, because we were trying to see if we could, my first game, first season in Vendsyssel, see if we could build a team that could promote the season after. And then suddenly we promoted in the playoffs, through the playoffs. Wow. No one expected that, and we built the team rapidly over the summer, and tried to make all these young and inexperienced players ready for the top league, and we did well. Beat Brøndby, beat FC Copenhagen, beat FC Nordsjælland, beat Odense, beat Aalborg in the first half of the season.
Wow, fantastic.
Which was quite remarkable. And then, of course, we struggled a little bit. And then suddenly, before we had to play the playoffs, the last playoff game, which we all expected that we were going to play, before we started the season. You know, they made an end to our you know, to the job I had there, and then I was you know, I had a lot of time to think about what would be the next good step for me. Ventus was one challenge with a team that was bottom of the league. It was a lot of, it was about developing a team that could withstand you know, the pressure from bigger clubs and better players.
Sure.
And then also try, you know, create players and teams who would be able to attack the opponents with and without the ball, but maybe not as intense as we are now.
Yeah.
With a top team. And you know, for me, even though it's a smaller league with less attention than the Danish league, it was a good, you know, I think a good challenge for me, first of all, to go abroad, which I love. I love getting new inputs.
Yeah.
Personally and also professionally. I think the surroundings up here are absolutely magical. And I met some people who are really good-hearted and really want the best for the club and were willing to give me the full responsibility to build the club and rebuild the club with young players and with the players and staff that I wanted to get in.
Mm.
And for me as a young manager, it was, you know, I think it was good for me to get that responsibility and learn from my mistakes, and try to do it the way I really want to do it.
Yeah.
With the, you know, with total backup from the board, and you know, of course, in a club that's not as fully equipped, you know, staff wise, with a lot of full time staff, then it, of course I get a I do a lot of things.
Mm.
That, you know, let's say in a bigger club that would be split over different roles, and it's also good for me to get my hands, you know, involved in different things.
Sure.
The managing, the coaching, the analyzing, the video editing, also the, but also the you know, sporting director role, which, you know, I also negotiate with agents, with players coming in, and get a lot of experience through that too.
Sure.
Which was really interesting for me.
I mean, when you made the move, you know, what was the challenge there from the club? Was it, you know,
yeah,
do
yeah.
you, are you expect, because you've won your first five games already, which is a really good record.
Yeah.
5 out of 5. I watched,
yeah,
the first game I watched, and you mentioned the you know, the scenery, the beautiful scenery. The first game I watched,
yeah,
was when you played IF, the second game of the season, I think.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it's like,
yeah,
the background was,
yeah,
incredible.
Unbelievable setting.
It's like,
yeah,
a,
yeah.
You know,
yeah,
it's like a really beautiful scenery,
yeah,
which I think maybe made me want to watch more games, to be honest. And that was when I thought, you know, let's talk. So, you know, what,
yeah,
what was the expectations when you moved there? And the other question on that is,
yeah,
obviously, you know, you read about it and it says it's a semi-professional league.
Yeah,
so what,
yeah,
is the actual professional status of it? How does it work? You know, for example, how often,
yeah,
do you train? How often do you,
yeah,
yeah, you know, it seems like Faroe Islands is such a small country. I think population 50,000. But
yeah,
how does it,
exactly,
operate, you know, practical, on a practical level? Is it quite,
yeah,
is it quite a football country, or is it quite, you know, you play the games and then it's quiet, or what's it like from that point of view?
Yeah, well, it's they're very, it's a very full football enthusiastic country. Everyone has an opinion, everyone follows football.
Yeah.
Of course, we don't attract like 5,000 for the game, but, and especially not right now, since, but I think today there was about 1,200-1,500 at the game, which is okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, the, you know, the job was, of course, to get the team back on track and able to fight for the championship.
Sure.
Because it's important for a club, you know, the most winning club, and the season they've had last year wasn't satisfying. They won the championship. We won the championship in 2018. And we're quite, you know, quite good.
Yeah.
Won most of the games, and then struggled a lot in following up on that the last season. And they wanted to also bring more of the young players into the first team.
Okay.
And they've, you know, they've seen what I've done with Ventures, you know, a small club with a very small budget, and a small foundation, and brought them into the Super League and did well and made some good results, and developed a lot of young players into you know, getting ready for the next level. And that was one of the you know, also important things in the job description. And you know, today our bench was two boys on 16, one on 17, one on 18, and then a goalkeeper and an old guy who couldn't play maximum who could play maximum 5 minutes because of his groin. so of course, because we have a lot of injuries, but still we have a young team and some young players who are doing well. We've put a guy in on it. He's 16. He's played all the games now. From the bench coming in, and it's something that they're really proud about, developing their own players here. And they're investing in you know, me as a full-time coach. I have a full-time assistant coach from Germany,
okay,
who's played hundreds of games in the second Bundesliga, also played in the Bundesliga when he was young for Werder Bremen under 21.
Wow.
Been in Holland and in the US as well. So you know, we bring our view of football and you know, experience from a different level to the club, and we're the first club who've hired a full-time physical trainer, physical coach.
Wow, that's fantastic.
And invested like about £30,000 in a new fitness room, you know, 200 square meter fitness room, gym with everything.
Mm.
So and it's paying off now. You can see that within the first 6 months. You know, the style of play, which is very aggressive and very demanding, with high pressure, and I hope you could see that a little bit today from the game and the game we played. And it's paying off. The players are doing well. A lot of the young players are shining at the moment. And even though we lost our biggest star, you know, the free kick master, who can also do a lot of other things besides that.
Yeah.
But we've lost him, you know, with a broken foot last week. The team is still performing, and other players are stepping in.
Yeah, and
you mentioned... a big part of it was bringing, you know, a lot of young players through to the first team, and also, you know, getting our winning edge back.
Sure.
To the whole club, and also, you know, tying the knot between the youth department and the first team, which was two different departments not working together that good last year.
Yeah, sure. I mean, yeah, you mentioned the player. I think is it Chukwudi, the 16-year-old, who has done quite well.
Chukwudi. Yeah, yeah. Samuel Chukwudi. Yeah. He's got an African father and a Faroese mother.
That's crazy.
Yeah. And he's 16. He's what, 6'4" or something like that. And he's really, really talented, and doing really well.
Yeah.
And you know, a good example of how it pays off to invest in the staff and the facilities is that he's gained like 5 kilograms of weight and muscle since January.
Yeah.
Because of the program he's been on with the weights, and we've reduced his training load a little bit. On the pitch, just 10%, 15%, and then adding it in the gym, and it's really paying off now.
That's fantastic. Yeah, and another player I noticed who did quite well in the game I saw was the left back. I think is it Johansson, perhaps. Can't remember his name.
Yeah, Daniel Johansson.
Yeah, great left foot.
Yeah, we've got like you know, 3 or 4 players who've been on the under 21 national team last season. And was, you know, been following each other there for many years, and they know each other well. The left back, the number 11, the striker Adrian, who's injured. Those three, they know each other well through many years and played together. So,
for sure.
So even though they're young, some of them they've played and been a part of the first team since they were 16, 17, and that's what we have to do, of course, in a league that's not as competitive as bigger leagues. We have to bring the most talented players around 16, 17, and you know, so they get in and around the team at that time,
yeah,
and get their first taste of it already, you know, in an early time. So when they're 21, they're quite experienced actually in senior in like adult football.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, what is the market like out there? And one question I had was it your first time in the Faroe Islands, or you know, had you been there before in the past? Because obviously, what's it been like for you from a cultural point of view? And yeah, then the other question to that is, yeah, like I say, what is it actually like? You know, you mentioned that you develop a lot of players. Maybe do the club want to sell players? Is there kind of like a market for them, or is it kind of how does it really operate in Faroe Islands? Because obviously, it's, to some people, they think it's so far away. What is the actual, I suppose, the transfer environment like, that kind of thing, with a view to the clubs developing and growing financially?
Yeah. Well, first of all, I hadn't been to Faroe Islands, and when I came the first time, even though the weather was not at its best in November when I came to visit, I said to myself, why haven't I been here before? Because it's absolutely beautiful. It's breathtaking.
Really?
Wherever you go, wherever you go, you're not more than five kilometers from the water, from the sea, and the scenery is unbelievable. Besides that, they're very, very nice people. Open people, are very curious and eager to learn, and very hardworking and robust, actually.
Wow.
So they're easy to move and easy to they really they really take it in, whatever you try to give them, especially if you're a little bit of curiosity and respect for their culture too, and how they do it, and I think that's important too, even though. And no matter how small a country you come to, and how big a role you have in order to change things, I think it's important that you show respect and that you're curious about their ways and their doings, and take a little bit, adapt a little bit of that too.
Yeah,
I think
it
makes it a lot easier for them to open up for you as well. What was the second question?
Just regarding the transfer environment, I mean, before you answer that, just to add to that, I mean, the Faroe Islands is as you mentioned, the population around 50,000, and you said they're very open and warm. Has there been any language issues, just before you answer that question on transfers? What's the is it the language barrier okay and that kind of thing? Cause,
Well, the funny thing is, when I was in Ventures, we had like half of the team were foreigners.
Right.
So everything we did, coaching, the written, stuff we did, all the material we produced, to teach the players, it was the video as well. It was in English, and all the coaching was in English. And it's like that in many clubs in Denmark now, because there's a lot of foreigners in Danish football.
Yeah, sure.
And then when I came here, I went abroad, and now I coach in Danish, because of course Danish is a second native language, and
exactly.
All the players, they all speak Danish, which makes it, of course, a lot easier for me. and I've always been good with languages. I speak German fluently. I speak a bit of French, Turkish, English, of course, and I enjoy picking up new languages, and it's Faroese, even though if you look at it quickly. And just if you don't really pay attention, it's difficult to understand. But if you really pay attention, and look at it, more thoroughly, when the written language, it's very similar to Danish.
Wow. Okay.
So after 6 months, I understand almost everything they say and write.
Fantastic.
Which makes it a lot easier for me, of course. And I pick up some of the words.
Yeah.
Every day I pick up new words.
It's fantastic.
So that's been quite easy, actually. Also for the, that sometimes when you coach on a language that's not your native tongue, it's the little details, the little nuances of the language, that's sometimes the things that make the difference when you coach, and when we have to, to really get close with the players and really find the little percentages that makes a difference when you coach, and when you try to influence players with your language and with what you say, when you have to inspire people, and you when you talk to them, and that's been a lot easier for me, of course, because I can use my mother tongue. So from that perspective, it's been easy, and it's been good.
And I mean,
and then regarding the transfer.
Mm-hmm. Do the clubs need to sell? Is there an ambition to sell players, for example? What is the is it kind of quite isolated, the league, and it's kind of, it just operates on itself, or is there a, you know, a link, or, you know, how does it work from that point of view? You, obviously, you mentioned you've developed young players. Even where do you find them, for example, on the island? Like, is it from an academy, or, you know, like, just tell us a bit about how it, what, how football operates there, if that makes sense.
Well, the thing is, of course, many, I think there's about 20 clubs in total, organized football clubs, 18 or 20. We have 10 in each league. I think there's four leagues, for where, of course, there's a professional league, the Betri Deildin, which is, means the Premier League. And then we have the First Division, Second Division, Third Division. And some of them consist of the second teams, the reserve teams, which are, which can play in, they can play, the reserve teams can play in the second league. And I think we want to bring more of our own players, homegrown players, into the first team than we have had the last couple of seasons. I think that the talents, they emerge everywhere, even on the smallest islands, isolated islands, they come, you know, every little tiny village, which is called a bygd up here, every little tiny village, they have their own football pitch, or or like a handball, you know, indoor gym, and that's where the, that's where kids go. Our home stadium, even though we play, you know, it's a stadium where you play Europa League qualification games, Champions League qualification games. It's open for everyone, all day, all year, and it means it's a big playground for the local kids. And it has to be, because you don't have a lot of, you don't have a lot of football pitches around the country, of course, due to the infrastructure. It's very, you know, there's, it's there's hills everywhere and mountains. And so they come there, the kids, they come there during, you know, during the day, night, weekend, all day long, and develop their skills. And then, of course, you have the clubs trying to organize it. And it's, you know, it's not like, you cannot compare even our youth department. You can compare it to like a normal amateur club in Denmark, with the structure and the, say, the budget and everything. It's not even close to like a academy level of football in Denmark, you know. So it's actually, it's actually impressive how many decent players they develop around the Faroe Islands, because it's parents coaching until they're 17, and then the best of them, they, when they're 16, 17, they go in the first team squad.
Because,
and the next best, they go to the second team squad.
It's fantastic. I mean, according to UEFA coefficients, they're ranked 52nd in the whole of Europe, out of 54. So that tells you a lot, you know, just above Andorra and San Marino and below Lithuania. But I'll be honest, you know, like you say there, I have been quite surprised with the level of the games I've seen. What do you put that down to? Is it just because, is it the main sport in the country, or is it, you know, is it just a reason that maybe it's untapped? Maybe it's not, people don't know about it as much. I know there's a TV deal they signed with Norwegian TV broadcaster now, to that will obviously get more exposure to the league. But what do you, you know? Do you think the coefficient can improve in the future? And is it a football mad country, or is there another sport maybe that dominates? Or?
I hope that it will improve in the coming years, and I think especially some of the, you know, some of the younger players from 18 to 23, they're quite talented. There's a good generation of young technical players who are aggressive, who can, you know, who can play with intensity on and off the ball, and I hope that the new national coach will play with a little more courage when he plays the games, especially when they play Andorra, Malta, Estonia, these types of countries where I think Faroe Island, you know, the Faroe Island team is better. They have better players. I hope they will be more, you know, offensive in their mindset of the games than they've been before, where it's been very, you know, sitting low, doing some counter attacks, not with the, you know, not with a lot of intention on trying to build up, because they have, I think, and that's what we try to show, they have players who can do that. We have the artificial turf, which, you know, we water us with sprinklers and everything, so we have a fast, even surface, and we can train on that all year round, which means we can have tempo and quality in our passing game.
Yeah.
And a lot of the teams, they still play very direct, and I think it's just down to the fact that maybe the coaching style is a little conservative still. And now I think what we try to do has opened the eyes a little bit of how much you can actually improve a Faroese team,
yeah,
and the way they try to attack the game and attack the opponent, not just only physical, but also technically and tactically.
For sure.
And hopefully that will make a difference over the coming years. I think with, you know, the new national coach, which has been, who's been under 21 Sweden national coach and done well with them, I think he's very impressed.
Yeah.
Also from what he's seen from the younger generation of players, and is very interested in what we're doing. And we have close cooperation with the Football Federation and the national team coach. Because I think, as I mentioned before, many of our younger players, they will be a big part of the national team over the next 10, 15 years.
Fantastic. And yeah, like you say, it does seem like there is some potential in the leagues there, maybe, that's been untapped. And maybe it's just a case of getting more exposure, maybe better coaching, like from people like yourself, maybe as well, to help the league grow. Let's talk about yourself, because you've had a long playing career as well, and a lot of experience in the game. You mentioned you talk different languages as well, and you've played in different leagues. So just for those who may not know, you began your career, I believe, in 2002 at Holstebro in,
yeah,
I believe, Denmark. Oh,
you've been digging deep, huh?
Yeah, we've got to do our research, you know. Yeah. We can't just invite anybody on. So, and then you moved to Silkeborg and then played over 100 games for that club before moving to Turkey. Kasim Pasa. Then you transferred to Norwich in 2009 and you won the league.
Yeah, that's correct.
With them in League One, in the third tier of English football at that time. So, you know, you've got a wide range of experience in different leagues. And you had a brief spell at Millwall and then moved back to sort of Denmark, Vejle, Edgeberg, before ending your career at Vendisla, I believe. So, you've had a really pretty decent career yourself. So, you know, tell us about some of the experiences. How did you end up moving to Turkey, and then obviously your time at Norwich as well? We've got one or two questions on that.
Yeah.
Before we move on to listener questions.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I had 4 decent years in Silkeborg where, you know, I made my name as a decent defender who could, you know, clear the ball and, you know, a good defender. And then the last season I didn't play my best season. And it was difficult after my contract expired. I wanted a new contract, and after playing 100 games for Silkeborg, I expected to get a little pay raise. They didn't want to give me that. And then I gambled a little and said, okay, then I'll see if I can find a new club. And it was difficult to find a new club in Denmark at that time.
Yeah.
And then suddenly I got this call from a Turkish agent because a team in Turkey, because this agent had been interested in me, and apparently my club had an offer on me about a year earlier, which I didn't know about.
Oh wow!
And then I've always been very adventurous and really enjoyed, you know, new challenges, meeting new people, seeing new places, being very curious about, you know, not only the world but also how do I adapt in new, you know,
of course,
with new challenges. New surroundings, and I think it was good for my football development and, you know, personal development to try something very different. And I've never been scared of, you know, challenges personally as well.
Yeah.
I've been very good at dealing with that, and I think that's why I even made a career, because I was not the biggest talent. A lot of people would sign that. And
I heard that you were a tough defender. Tough man.
So
defender.
I got this offer from Turkey. I looked at my wife, and she looked at the weather forecast, and the place. She looked a little bit at Istanbul, and we said, well, why not? And let's go there. And then I signed a 2-year contract. And you know, I don't know if you've heard many stories about Turkey, but you know, a few Danish players have been in Turkey.
Yeah.
and they've had a lot of crazy stories to tell, and I can tell all of them. I've everything you can imagine about Turkey, I've experienced it.
What's the craziest story that you can tell us this, that we're allowed to publish, maybe, or allowed to, allowed to talk about?
Yeah, what's the craziest story? Well, I've you know, a teammate of mine, he wanted to fix games.
Wow.
And he got nailed for it a couple of years later.
Oh wow.
Fans shooting in the club because they weren't happy with the results.
What?
I had six different coaches within the first 6 months because they sacked them every 2 weeks.
Wow.
You know, sacrificing of sheep on the pitch just before the kickoff of training games. Well, you name it, everything.
Definitely sounds like a crazy adventure.
Yeah, it was crazy, but you know, at the time it was hard, and you know, being sent on a training camp with half a day's notice and leaving my wife and small kids. Mm. We started a family in these years, so it was quite difficult too. You never knew when I was home.
Right.
Spending more time in hotels and with my family.
Mm.
So it was a big challenge for me and my family. Of course, but something we would not be without now. And you know, looking back at it, we can laugh at all the crazy things we experienced within those 2 years. But it, you know, it's something that really strengthened the family tie, and it was good for us. But of course, after 2 years and with a lot of crazy stuff, we felt like it was time. Even though I had offers at better clubs in Turkey, we felt like it was time to settle down a little bit and find something that was a little bit more, you know, a little bit more similar to what we were used to.
Sure.
With the Danish culture. And then, of course, you know, when I heard about the option to go on a trial in Norwich, you know, it didn't take long to say, I'll take it.
Sure, of course. And, so you went on trial.
Yeah.
You went on trial there. And then,
I went on trial, and what, you know, my luck was that they had just come from a 6 week holiday. And you know, I've always been really good at using my holidays for good preparation. So I was fit when I came.
Oh, fantastic!
And and that helped me a little bit because maybe I was a little bit fitter than the other guys, so I looked really good and sharp in these 2 weeks.
Preparation is key.
Yeah, which earned me a contract. Yeah, so thank God for that.
Yeah.
And then okay. A fantastic time in my career as a footballer, and for my family as well. You know, we all cried that when we had to leave Norwich. But of course, having not played that many games the last season and a half because of, you know, at first injury, and then of course second of all that the players playing, they just did really well. So it was hard to get back into the team.
Sure.
We weren't ready to leave Norwich, but we had to because I had to find a new club. So, so it was a special time, very special time.
I mean, we've got a listener question actually, but I'll start with one question for you. Describe English football for somebody who is new to English football from, say, Scandinavia. Yeah. You know, what was you just said you loved it. What attracted you to English football? You know, what was? Yeah. Tell us, you know, that feeling of English football. What did you gain from it?
You know, if someone asked me that too, and I can only just, if I use one word, it's passion.
Yeah.
You know, the passion you experience there, and it's not just, you know, on the pitch, it's not just in the club, it's from everyone around, you know, and the whole environment around football in England is something that, you know, I've never, you know, I wasn't lucky enough to play in Germany. I think there's a little bit of it too, but. The passion about football, about the game, from the supporters. You know, in Denmark, it's spectators. They come, they watch a game, they want to be entertained. In England, they come and they contribute with everything they have. You know, every fiber of their body.
Yeah.
The whole stadium, they just give everything to the game. And that was really, really special for me to experience that. I was lucky to find an apartment really, you know, in the center of the city, and it was just 200 yards from the ground, from Carrow Road.
Yeah,
and you know, even though it took me 2 minutes to walk to the stadium, I had to you know, walk You know, I had to leave home at least 20 minutes, 25 minutes before the game, or before I had to be there, because there were so many fans already 2 hours before the game wanted to just give me a bit of, you know, a heads, you know, well done, good luck today. I want to hear a little bit about this and that. And, you know, I can sign an autograph. Oh, it's going really well. You know, they were so, you know, everyone lives football in England. And that was really, really special. So the passion, also from the players, you know, in the energy, and I really thrive with that, because I'm also very passionate myself about football, about winning, and for me to experience that was, you know, something that I really cherish, and really I feel really privileged that I've, you know, played in a club.
And at
a level, and also at a time where it went really, really good, and been a part of that. I've been just a tiny part of that. It's you know, something that I really hope to experience that again as a manager, as a coach.
Because
that's something I work on, being good enough to go there.
You had
and see if what I can do with the British team.
Yeah, because you had a really good season there as well. Of course, Norwich had a hard time before that, and you won the title there. You know, what was it like being in the city and that kind of thing? Because there's a lot of obviously Norwich fans who remember you.
Yeah.
You know, what's your memories of them and the club in that season?
Yeah, well, I can only say I've never experienced anything like that. You know, the friendliness. The it was like a family, a big family, and it was even though I had small kids, you know, it was always safe to bring the family to the stadium. And that's, you know, I had a month in Millwall, and it was a totally different thing, you know, the experience from coming to the game. We were told, don't park your car outside the premises, don't stop the car if anyone, you know, approaches you outside the stadium. Lock the doors, keep the windows, you know, up, closed. And in Norwich, I could send my own kids walking alone to the stadium. And the fans, they would just carrying them inside.
Yeah.
You know, it was very special, that the atmosphere in Norwich. And also when we went to the city centre, you know, always people coming up with respect, you know, giving us a pat on the back or wishing us good luck, or, you know, even though, you know, the last season I had in Norwich, I didn't contribute much on the pitch. I was just, you know, I was training, trying to get back in the team. It was difficult. And they were still, you know, people still write at me, even though it's 10 years ago I was there.
Fantastic.
And still, you know, confront me when we visit Norwich now and then.
Yeah.
Because we still have friends there, and they still, you know, and thankful for what I've given to the club. And I think, well, I've just been such a tiny part of it. I played like 30 games and that's it, the first 6 months, and then I didn't play much of a role. But they still remember, and they appreciate players who've given what they had to the club. And, it's special. It's very special, and I hope, as I said again, I hope that I can experience that form of passion again as a manager.
Yeah, I mean, I think that leads me to the next question, and then what we'll do is we'll ask some listener questions off that. But I imagine that from what you've just said there, how much you loved it, the passion. I imagine you have ambitions to maybe come back to English football maybe one day as a manager.
Oh, I hope so.
Yeah.
I hope so. You know, I wanted to see how far I could take it when I was a player. And, you know, for me, it was about every day being the best, because if you're one of the best, then you get the chance to move on. And no matter where you are, if you shine, if you do well, then eventually some people will notice it and say, look, maybe he's ready for the next step. And I'm still young, I have a lot to learn. But I've had, you know, I've promoted twice as a coach, once as assistant coach, once as a head coach. And now you know, I learn every day here from a great experience here, with talented players and a club that is eager and willing to move in the direction that I'm trying to take it, and that's really, really good experience for me. And yeah. hopefully soon we have to, you know, we have our Europa League qualification games in the summer,
of course,
which is also something that's very exciting for me as a manager, to get that experience under the belt,
for sure,
which is something very different from being the favorite and you know the every game we enter now, that we have to also, you know, while we are preparing, you know, coaching, I'm preparing a team that has to control and dominate the games every time. I also have to develop a team and players that can defend and who can take the underdog role and still get a good result, which is very interesting.
Yeah. I mean, can I ask, how do you, you know, I suppose two questions on that. What is your managerial philosophy? Is it too early to say that you have one? Maybe is it more based around the players you have, or do you have a philosophy that you aspire to? Maybe, you know, people that you look up to, for example, managers that you look up to. And also, you're a young coach. So when your career ended, obviously you moved from Norwich, then you moved eventually back to Denmark. When you thought to yourself, right, I want to be a manager maybe in the future, what did you do to learn, and what do you do even now to keep learning as a manager, you know, to keep adapting? Are there any particular advices that you would give, say, to another person who wants to coach maybe, or you know, how do you keep yourself prepared and learning all the time? Do you believe more in, you know, man management, or do you believe more in sort of tactics, that kind of thing? You know, what's the key on that side of things?
I believe in people. And I'm lucky to have three kids myself, and I have a strong belief in them, and I've experienced, and every parent would say that, you know, if you really spend some energy and put some belief in your own kids, then they will grow. And if you also, you know, put some high demands in them and really push them, they will do much more than you would dream of. And it's, for me, it's the same with the players. I'm here to make their dreams come true, and it means that I have to push them every day and teach them that they can actually and do more than what they think they can do. And I think that's my most important job.
Yeah.
Managing style wise, you know, I believe in being aggressive. I believe in attacking. You know, attacking. We attack the opponent. If we have the ball, or if we don't have the ball, I don't like passive football. I like taking the initiative. I want my team, my players, to express themselves on the pitch, to show some joy, some passion, and some respect for the game. You know, that's what I think is interesting to watch. That's what I think is the future of football. For young players, want to do more, to be aggressive, to take the initiative, to be able to attack the opponent as high as possible and as much as possible. Also in the phases where you don't have the ball, I don't like passive football. And I don't. You know, I'm 37. I don't think I should give advice to young managers.
Okay.
But I think you need to find out what you like about football, and then that's what I've, you know, the football I like to play and what I like to watch, that's what I want to try and coach and teach at the same time. I think you can take it very far if you're very uncompromising, if you have a very uncompromising approach to managing players and how the game is played. You can, you know, some of the best coaches in the world, they're known for being extremely relentless when it comes to their principles and the way they manage their players. I believe that's very important when it comes to your values, but I also think a very good coach is able to accept that not everything is solved all the time by following the exact same road. I believe that being flexible and adaptable, also when it comes to the man managing, is for me the right solution sometimes. To deal with different tactical challenges, and that's why I'm very curious. I always see, can we find new and better solutions? because football develops at such a rapid pace that what's the right solutions now might not be the right solutions in 2 or 3 years' time. So I have to, you know, to get that winning edge, I need to be one step ahead all the time. So that's why we sit like 7-10 hours in the office every day and trying to design new exercises.
Yeah.
So we don't just repeat and repeat and repeat, and then some, and then eventually, before we know it, we'll be left behind.
Of course. I mean, you sound to be honest, you sound like a top guy. To be honest, I feel like I want to come out and play for you. You know, that was quite inspirational. Like some of the words you say there, in believing in human beings.
If you can play striker, I might look into.
I'll be out there. Yeah, I'll get my plane ticket. There's no coronavirus, so we can come out of quarantine.
On the 15th, you can enter the country without being in quarantine.
Fantastic.
So we have to wait 14 days.
Yeah, I'm up for that. I'll get my boots. Yes. We got some listener questions before we finish.
Yes.
Really, really appreciate your time. You know, thank you so much for your time joining us.
Of course.
I'll finish with some questions, so I don't want to keep you too much longer. But yeah, we got we'll start with one from the 94th minute, who asks, how would you say Faroese football has developed over the years, and are you inspired by the improvements that have been achieved there, and other countries like Iceland as well? Do you look at other countries like that, maybe, who have developed and you know, see that Faroe Islands, you know, how big can the league grow, I guess, is what the question is, essentially.
Yeah, that's a very good question. Well, to be honest, I haven't followed Faroese football over the last couple of years because, you know, I've been busy with my own stuff in Denmark.
Yeah, of course.
So of course, since I've come up here, since the last 6 months, I've tried to look a little bit behind and see how have they done it the last couple of seasons. How has the league developed? I look at the statistics, of course, for all the teams throughout the last 10, 15 years. Also to set my own personal goals as to, you know, how many records can we try to beat this season, which is very motivating for me and my coaching staff, and also for the players. And I know I had an Icelandic player last season who did really well, a 19-year-old boy who's, you know, a product of the modern Icelandic football development, technically good players. Who can actually play, not only fight, but he had both, and that was very interesting for me. You know, he was technically very gifted, very clever. His perception was exceptional. His individual qualities was really good, but he was also, you know, his mentality and his toughness, physically, mentally, was at a very high level for a 19-year-old. And that's the mix of that is what I think they've done really well in Iceland. Because they have, I know the national, you know, the assistant coach on the national team very well. He's a good friend of mine.
Okay.
We took the pro license, on the pro license course together, and he said, look, they know they cannot be world champions when it comes to football, but when it comes to mentality, they want to be the best team in the world, and that's what they really focus on too, in everyday training. How they express themselves in the game, the signals they sent to each other on the pitch, and that was really interesting to me. So they are very ambitious about their football, about the way they play.
Yeah,
of course, I think there's a lot to learn from that. The thing that they've built indoor football pitches, you know, where they can play in all sorts of weather, is something that's really been a huge generator for football development.
Right.
On Iceland, and I'm trying to convince the Football Federation here that would be a very good idea for us too, because I've had many training sessions where we've set up all the training with all the gear, and then the wind just sweeps everything away because it's very windy up here.
Oh wow!
That would be very helpful. There's like a half-size pitch on one of the islands, but they're still discussing if they should build one of these indoor full-size football pitches, where it should be, if it should be in Tórshavn or if one of the other bigger cities.
Right.
And So I think with the focus right now, which you've also mentioned from Norway, Denmark, Sweden, and also that you're giving, with your podcast that you're giving Faroese football, it's really, really good for the country. And some journalists asked me, 2 weeks before we started the league here, Do you think that it will mean a lot to Faroese football? You know, the focus that you had on, I was like, let's wait and see how much that actually means.
Yeah.
Because, let's not you know, exaggerate the value of maybe one of the games being televised in Norwegian football. But after being involved in a month now, you know, in the league and the entire focus that we've had and how it's created a debate up here about the way we referee the game, you know, the decision on the game, the whole surroundings of the game, the setup, the TV production, everything is being discussed now at a national level, and it's very good. Very good for the development of football. It pushes everyone.
Yeah, I think, you know. On that note, just to point out, Tórshavn is actually the capital of the Faroe Islands, I believe.
Yes.
And also, just as a follow up on that, yeah, you're right. I think, you know, if I may just say something quickly, I think the ability to react very quickly from the pandemic, obviously, I think, you know, has brought a great focus on Faroe Islands. That's how I started watching it, to be honest, because it was like the only league
we've been lucky
we could watch.
We've been really lucky.
Yeah.
That we've had a head start.
Yeah. So. I think that's definitely, you know, it's an opportunity, isn't it, for the league to grow, like you say, and develop maybe.
I hope so. I really hope that we don't just, you know, drop back into our old habits after the focus has disappeared a little bit because now the bigger leagues they start now in the next period of time, and Germany's already started and so on. Denmark is starting again now, and I really hope that you know. How we've come on our toes now, all of us, and we've been a little bit provoked also about, you know, in Norway, for example, they've been laughing laughing at the referees, the level of the referees, and how you can just, you know, slaughter each other up here without being sent off, or sometimes not even getting a yellow card or a free kick, and it's a debate that has started to rise already when we played the first three training games because I saw a lot of nasty, late tackles with no intention whatsoever of playing the ball. And it's something I've been working really hard on to get out of our game because I don't like it. And I don't, you know, if my players has to develop and be able to take it on to the next step, they have to be able to win the one versus one defensive challenges without just kicking the opponent.
Of course.
And I think that the focus now that we've had from Norway, especially, it's kind of, you know, put some gasoline to the fire.
Definitely.
That started a little bit already.
I mean, I saw it.
I hope, because that's what, you know, if the referees start to give these little free kicks, it will force the teams to improve their defensive skills. It will force the coaches to say, look, we can't just kick the opponent because then we'll get sent off.
Yeah.
We have to work more tactically better. We have to be physically stronger. We have to be fitter so we can cover the gaps better. And I hope that will be an effect. So the football in general will improve.
For sure. No, I saw the IF game, and I think there was about 6-7 yellow cards, and I thought the game was. There was quite. You had a player sent off as well in the early second half.
Yeah.
And I thought it was.
Some
of the challenges were quite rough, but then some of them were. I thought the referee was. He was quite happy to get the card out. I thought sometimes, but.
Sometimes it's difficult to understand. You know, sometimes they give very, very soft free kicks.
Yeah, I thought there was a few soft ones.
And then 2 minutes later, one guy he just launches it for 2 feet, and you know if the opponent, if he doesn't jump for his life, he will lose both his legs just below the knee. So he just play on. He says. So it's difficult, especially for my Danish players. I have three Danish players who played at the top level in Denmark.
Right.
One has even played in the Scottish Premier League in 2019.
Okay.
And of course they struggle a little bit to adapt. They're not afraid of the physical part of the game, and neither was I when I played. And I appreciate the physical part of the game, but I want us to play with an intent of winning the ball.
Of course.
It's a bit like watching sometimes when you watch some of the games. It's a bit like watching English football 30 years ago.
Yeah, it's quite physical. Yeah, definitely.
Where, yeah, yeah, And I hope, I really hope, that the extra focus we've had will take us to the next level.
Yeah. We've got a question from Neil Baxter, who asks, yes, how do you go about enticing players to play in the Faroe Islands? And, you know, how adequate is the players pool for clubs? And how could it be better? He's a big fantasy football player as well, so he says, which players should I have in my fantasy team? But we'll start with the question about getting players to the Faroe Islands. How does that work?
Yeah.
And, you know, for transfer, that kind of...
Of course, I have players now. I was lucky to bring in one of my players that I've coached before in Wenceslas and in Skive, where I was playing assistant coach. Mm. And of course, you know, him knowing me already and the way I manage and develop, you know, players and want to play the game, it, you know, he knew that already, so that was a bit of a help. But then I always invite players, new players. I invite them up. We pay for their hotel. We make them stay here for, you know, 2, 3, 4, 5 days, however long they want. And I invite them to join the training so they can feel on their own body how I coach, how we train, and also, you know, the level of the teammates and the intensity of the game. Because some of them, of course, they doubt about, you know, Faroese football. How good can it be? And I can only say that all the guys I've had up here, they've been willing to stay after they've experienced that on their own body. Even though, you know, top clubs from the Danish first division in the second league, they gave an offer to them too, maybe even a better offer. They thought this was a great place for them to develop. And also, everyone who comes up here, you know, if not the Faroese players because they know it, but the Danish players, for example, they when they see the surroundings here, they think, wow, you know, that's also a part of it.
Mm.
So on a personal level, it's also a fantastic experience for them too. And not all Danish players get to play Europa League or Europa League qualification games.
Exactly.
So that's winning a championship or a cup or a cup final.
Mm.
And that's also something that they, you know, experience and also something they learn from, and who's developing them to take the next step. So it's a mix of all these things. You know, of course, my plans for them. We have a lot of focus on the individual development too.
Yeah.
With individual training plans, with where we test them, we you know, we follow them very closely.
How often do you
feedback every week with video and stuff?
How often do you train? Is it because it's semi-professional?
Yeah.
Is it,
also
is it?
That. Yeah. Of course, we train just as much as in a full-time club in Denmark or in England. We train 7 times a week and we play our game.
Oh wow! Okay.
And of course, I have many players who work. Some of them work full time, 40 hours a week. And then that means that we can train 5 o'clock in the afternoon.
Yeah.
But then once a week they come in at 6:20 in the morning, and then we have our weight training at 6:30 for an hour. And we serve breakfast to them, and then we send them off to work at 8 o'clock.
Wow.
And then they come back and train in the afternoon. And then on Thursdays we also have an extra training session for the guys who are not working from 8 to 10.
Yeah.
Where we do some, you know, we have individual, you know, focused things with, you know, position specific training, where we try to develop the individual qualities of them, and also video meetings, you know, for the players who have part-time jobs or who are at school. And it also means that, you know, a lot of the young kids on 16, 17, 18, who are still in college, they can, of course, be a full part of the squad because we train outside school hours.
Yeah. Yeah, I think...
Which is perfect. So the football developing environment is on the same level as a full-time club, as a Super League club in Denmark.
Yeah,
and that's also a major part in us being able to bring in good players.
Yeah, I can imagine. I think, you know, there's a lot of players in England, for example, who are out of contract who, you know, listening to that, like, it's, you know, for example, semi-professional players in England who play to a fairly good level but still work and that kind of thing. You know, maybe they want, if they want a new experience, that sounds like a, you know, a fairly similar sort of lifestyle in terms of working and playing.
It's good. You know, of course, not all the players I have can live from football alone.
Yeah.
You know, from the wages they get. I think maybe a handful can, and the rest they have to you know, work part time next to it. But you know, from a development, you know, perspective, the environment is really, really good. And of course, you know, with my experience as a player and what I strive for as a manager, and with my assistant coach, who's also played at the top level. I think he had one game in the Champions League from when he was young. You know, we know what they have to do, and how good they have to be to get at the highest level, and that's where how much we push them. My physical coach is extremely talented, and he will take it very far too.
That's fantastic.
So you know, I have a lot of, especially right now, I have a lot of agents, a lot of players, you know, approaching me. You know, with players who've played at a lot higher level than Faroese football, because they know we're playing right now.
Yeah, I can imagine.
And they also see that maybe it's not the worst place to you know, to kickstart your career again if you've struggled a little bit.
For sure.
With injuries and not playing for a, but we are also very picky, because the level of the players here, especially in my club, is good. And they have to be, and also, you know, the mentality has to be strong. So I tend to be very picky about what I bring in, because the culture and in the team, and the togetherness in the team is extremely important for me.
Yeah, of course, and you've won, you've won every game so far as well. So the level must be pretty high within your squad. I mean, the question that Neil asks about the players, we'll tie that into the next question, because there's another one, one final one we'll go for. Blues fan 555 says, is there any team you've played that has really given you trouble? It might be a bit early in the season for that, but maybe you might have one. And who would you say is the best young player in the Betri Deildin? And he says that isn't Andrian Justinusson, of course. So maybe to tie that question into Neil's one, if you could maybe pick like three players there that people new to the league should maybe watch out for, It could be three HB players if you want, but you know, it's up to you.
Yeah.
So I'll leave it open.
Good. Well, first of all, what was the first question?
Is there any team that's given you trouble? You know,
Of course. Of course, the game today was tough. Being 2-1 down, of course we struggled, and we had to really, really dig deep to get the momentum back. It's been one of the toughest opponents, obviously, from a physical point of view, and also, you know, from the individual quality they have on the players. But they also struggled a lot. You know, we didn't have difficulties in finding the openings, you know, tactically wise in their 4-2-3-1, because there was a lot of space when we played past the first, the front four. And around the defensive midfield, two defensive midfielders, there was a lot of space.
Yeah,
and we were good at exploiting that. I don't know if you noticed, but
we tried
that. And also that back four is very unorganized.
Yeah, you pulled them out of position a lot.
Defense. So that's of course something we've worked on a lot, and it wasn't a lot more difficult against them than it has been, you know, with the other opponents.
Mm.
But offensively, okay, they gave us a lot harder challenge to shut them down. They also have, you know, they put a lot of balls in the box from set pieces also, which we have to, of course, really, really struggle with, and you know, put up the fight. Also, both, you know, on the first ball, second ball, third ball, because anything can happen when they really put it in there. And they had a really strong, tall central defender who was a handful.
Yeah.
And you know, I would say the playing style in Faroese football is maybe the biggest, and how much the referee allow in the duel is maybe the biggest challenge for us, because we try to play very close to the opponent, very technically, with a lot of short passing, a lot of, you know, playing in small spaces.
Yeah.
that means that, of course, we, you know, we get a lot of bad tackles our way, thrown our way, and not all of them even give a free kick. So that's something that's a big challenge for us. And it's, you know, we don't. That's just how it is, and we have to deal with that. And the first couple of games, we've struggled a little bit about, you know, mentally dealing with it. We've had too many stupid yellow cards because we don't keep our minds cool, and two unnecessary red cards. Luckily today, the red card was shown the other way, which was, I think, you know, the right, I would say,
decision.
Yes, that was the right decision. You know, I think we should have drawn, you know, a few more red cards out of the opponents, you know, to the opponents the last couple of games, but sure, we haven't. Yeah. And that's something that we have to deal with. I've spent a lot of time talking with the players about that, showing them video about, you know, not making stupid late tackles, and trying to avoid them. And also, you know, making the referees aware that when we are exposed of nasty tackles, you know, Adrian Justinussen, he could have broken his leg in the first game, because a guy just kicked him with full power. The ball was 10 yards away when he kicked him, and it's horrible to see. I don't like it. I think it's you know, it shows a lack of respect for the opponent, for the football in general.
Yeah, it got a bit heated, didn't
that's,
it?
Yeah, that's the, I think right now for us is the biggest challenge. Because we can open up all the teams, also the best teams, but if the game, you know, is played the way they want to, very physical, a lot of hard tackles, then of course it gets difficult for us.
Sure, sure.
Then we have to keep, especially the mental part of it, because we'll take the jewels. You know, we're not shy of that and are afraid, but of course it's a mental challenge to keep your mind cool when you get, you know, when you just get kicked,
yeah,
you know,
definitely,
for no reason, like 5-10 times in a row.
For sure.
So that's something that we spend a lot of time on trying to improve also in the training.
And the players too.
Yeah, you mentioned.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're the players. Well, of course, Adrian is, I think, I'm sure he's the Faroese player with the highest potential for many, many years. He's an extreme talent. He's got a right foot. I've never seen anything like that. Also not when I played in England.
That's just a new thing.
He's got so many. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and he's got so much more, you know, so much offensive attacking quality, but he's also extremely hardworking and a good pressing player too. His touch in high pace, his first touch, his perception, he can play the passes out of, you know, the corner of his eye with quality. So he's extremely good. Of course, taking him out of the picture, you have a Petro Knudsen, from Runavik, from NSI, who's very talented too, also 21-year-old, extremely, extremely fast. He can dribble, he's got a good shot. Also a very good player. And then I think our left fullback, Daniel Johansson, is also a good talent. He's 21,
and he's
getting better and better and better. He was mostly used as a defensive midfielder the last couple of seasons, but now since our left fullback from last year, he went to Iceland. Now the space opened up, and I think he's a very modern fullback with a great vision, a fantastic left foot. He's very composed on the ball. He can play long. He can play inside the pitch, and he's just improving every week.
Yeah, I think he's
doing really,
player.
Really well.
I like him as well. I think he's got great left foot.
Yeah, fantastic, fantastic left foot. Also on set pieces and so on. And he's getting better and better on his defensive part of the game too, which he really has to, and has worked hard on improving.
Yes. No, that's fantastic. I mean, appreciate your time. You know, we ran on a little bit more than we expected, but I really appreciate you joining us. It's been fascinating talking, and like I say,
I've enjoyed it.
If you continue to do well, I think, you know, maybe we'll see you back in England one day. You know,
we'll
who
see.
Knows? So
we'll
hope that can happen for you.
I hope so.
but we'll keep in touch, obviously. In the now we know that Faroese football is improving.
And thanks for your interest in in Faroese football. Yeah, it's good for all of us who's up here.
Yeah, so, no, it's fantastic.
I appreciate that.
No problem at all. And I thank you again for your time. Well done so much on the win today.
Thanks.
And thanks for joining us on this episode.
Absolutely. No problem.
We're going to wrap it up now. Yeah, so thanks, guys, for listening. And we'll be back for another episode later this week. So take care. The new seasons are starting on the 14th and 16th of June in Sweden and Norway. So we'll be back very soon with some season previews. But in the meantime, thank you for listening and goodbye.